If we pass, we get started. Hi, folks. How's everybody doing? Hopefully good. Today is the fifth part of the second series of the first chapter of the first epic of Tableau Coders Initiative. Today we wrap up the embedding API. So we've had fun along the way. We've got to do a lot of stuff. We'll see how today goes. Might not, be as amazing as it has been, but we'll see. I don't know. How's doing most of the stuff today? So could be
So
anything.
yeah, we're starting off on the wrong foot. Hey,
Yeah.
Zach, by the way, just sorry to interrupt, but since you're the only host, I think you're the only one that can let people in. So if you could just,
Ah, what a mess.
I
Just
know, and I can't edit the event since it already started. So sorry.
gosh. All right. Well, this guy's Kyle. He's no, that's him. I'm Zach. You know that if you're here for the fifth time, then you stuck with us. You're one of the best people we know. Welcome to the initiative. You know what our goal is. We want to teach you to code with Tableau, the APIs, the developer tools, foster safe and friendly environment for everybody except for Kyle. We've been starting to talk a little bit, Kyle and I, about what's next. So we are going to focus on the extension API next, show you kind of some of the cool out there things that you can do with the extension API. We'll talk a little bit more about that towards the end of today's session, but hopefully get you excited to start learning about extensions coming up. Data dev update, not a lot here still. A couple things coming up. We do have, from Tableau's perspective, Salesforce's Dreamforce conference next month. I didn't really put anything on there, but that is coming up next month. Tableau conference was just announced for end of April next year in San Diego. Nice switch from Las Vegas finally. A couple things along those lines. We did call out just Tableau's done a good job of starting to get some more stuff on the website for developer programs. So I always encourage you to check out both the events page, which there's nothing on there right now, but also the learning resources. There's a few new things in here. Last time we were together, we talked about the embedded playground. That's officially went live. Some plans for partition cookie support. That's really exciting stuff. And some more tutorials about the API. This one uses Angular JavaScript. So you want to find some other opportunities to learn this stuff. So there's some things out there for that. Just a little bit of a recap of what we went over last time. So we got acquainted with some of the basics of JavaScript. Talked about how you can use JavaScript, and that is available there in CodePen. We continued the interactive resume, and all of the previous sessions, of course, are on YouTube if you did miss them. Let's talk a little bit about coding. So I'm going to show a little bit on the resume side that we've been talking about over the last couple sessions. Let me admit those folks since Kyle failed. There's a few people there. All right. Let's go to the resume. So if you guys remember, we've talked about this a couple times throughout the series. The first level was this, where we did some simple embedding. We had just a little bit about ourselves, some links to LinkedIn, things like that, about me, and just a embed of a dashboard. We then went on to Kyle's improvement. Kyle's improvement to this, had an image and some hideous buttons on here, and a little bit more formatting when it came to the dashboard or the worksheet down there. And then I just overhauled it, and I did all this completely on my own. Didn't take this from anybody or anything like that. This was all me, a kid. So what I really want to emphasize here is really once you start to learn the basics of this kind of stuff, you don't always have to build everything from scratch. It is always good to look at what's out there. So this one, for example, what I did was I went out CodePen. I searched resume and I looked through here to find something that interests me. There's a lot of cool things out here. One of the first ones is right here, this responsive resume template. He's got some really cool, interesting things going on, some stuff going on with the JavaScript up here. I didn't want to, you know, have too much going on with this weird blobby thing. So I took that part out. But otherwise, what I really did was I just took that, I took that little bit of code out, and then I just made the text a little better. So, you know, things like my email here, my totally real email. My name is Zach Barry. Best thing about me is that I'm nothing like Kyle. In fact, I'm better in nearly every possible way. You know, my experience, my job experience here. So, you know, right now I'm a director. My job is to tell Kyle what to do. Before that, I was a VP, pretty much more of the same. And then before that, from 1942 to 2019, I was a web designer, and pretty much always telling Kyle what to do. What can I say? He's helpless. But, you know, there's some other cool things in here. I do encourage you to take things like this, find them. This is rather complex compared to what we've done before. There's a lot of things going on in here, but really just searching for text and finding different places and modifying them. That's the best way you can learn to code. So I went through here, updated these with my real skills. So Tableau, Alteryx, web development, a comparison versus Kyle, a comparison similarities to Kyle, and then just being the best. So I put them out of a, you know, percentage out of 100. These are all real numbers. And then simply just to show that you can modify this. So again, the example was just, this is a hobby section. You know, I flipped this out and, you know, just found a spot where it made sense to put a little dashboard object. And so that's what's going on here. You can find this in this little part right here. So it still says hobby, but I've got a little dashboard. And again, this is just showing me versus Kyle in just all ways. You know, Kyle did have a little bit of a jump here in the middle, but he just was blown away pretty quickly in that.
August was a good month for me. Yeah.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, you did decent right there. And that's this month. So hey, this is your time. This is your time to shine, Kyle.
This is it.
So that's really it, just kind of wrapping up the resume. You know, again, just emphasize there's a lot of cool things here on CodePen, and this is just one example. There's other places like Dribbble and other websites like that where you can find examples that are designed and or coded that you can go in and modify. I think that's the best way going forward. If you want to continue your journey, learn more about how to do this, find some things that you're interested in and start to personalize them, make them your own. And, you know, there's a lot that can be said to just inching along that way to learn these languages a little bit better. And if you want to check this out and play around with the code, you just need to go to CodePen and search for my name. All of Kyle's pens are also available under his name, albeit they're not as nice. you can find either of our sets here, you know, just by searching first for CodePen. So with that said, I'm going to pass it to Kyle, and Kyle is going to go a little bit more into the details of coding.
Yep. And Zach, I do just want to point out that I really like that your suggested search was Reptile Spider-Man. Don't know what that was about, but that was fun.
My son, right before this,
came to ask what reptile is.
I still have he has the coloring book over there. But I was like, I think it's just reptile. But in my head, I was like, it's got to be better than that. And no, it wasn't. It was just reptile. So not a great name for Spider-Man villain, but yes, that was my last search.
Yeah, blame it on Gray. That's nice. That's blame it on good. The 4-year-5-year-old.
Yeah, there you go. All right. It's all right. The host now. Go ahead and fail.
All right. Thanks for the vote of confidence there. All right. Thanks, everybody. So yeah, so Zach was showing us as we become accustomed to with our sessions, a lot of things you can do in CodePen, how you can search through CodePen and find some inspiration and modify things to your liking. I'm going to switch it up a little bit, and we're going to go into more of the heavy lifting when it comes to the embedding API. And we're going to be working out of VS Code today. So I'm going to try to go at a reasonable pace, but there's a lot here. I don't want you to get overwhelmed. And all of this code will be available after the session. So if you have questions, then we can touch base, or we'll leave some time at the end as well. But I'm going to go ahead and pull up VS Code here and an example, and we will get into a little bit more nitty gritty here. So in CodePen, as we were used to seeing, we had kind of our three sections. We had our CSS, our HTML, and then our JavaScript down at the bottom. So in this first example, I'm kind of doing the same thing. Zach's holding up lizard venom something or other trying to
Yeah,
distract.
see, 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 see.
So in this first example, which I will actually show you what it looks like in a second here, but you can see here we have kind of a similar setup in terms of we've got our HTML first, and then down at the bottom, we've got a bunch of JavaScript. And it is, there's a lot here, but I'll walk us through it. It'll make more sense. And then we'll go into a second example page that is a little bit more real world, how you would probably do it if you had a more production ready project. So one of the nice things, or one of the caveats with using the embedding API, is that the page that you're running it on needs to be hosted by a server. So like if you're running it in CodePen, that's hosted on a server. If I were to just open this index.html file just that's sitting on my local computer from like the file explorer, a lot of the embedding stuff wouldn't work. It's just because it needs to be on a web server. But one of the nice things about VS Code is it has that built in for you, so you don't have to do anything special. So if I just go over to this index.html and right click on it and do open with live server, VS Code will actually just start a little virtual server and then actually launch it. It launched over here. But now it is running this page as though it were running out on the web somewhere, and I have full functionality to anything that I want to do here. So what are we looking at here? I'm going to open another important tool that I just opened up here when you're developing and learning how these things worked is called the Inspector inside of the browser. It's available in every browser. It's a standard thing. And in almost all of them, you can open it from any page just by hitting the F12 key. So when I do this, you'll see a pane pops out. I've got various tabs that I can inspect and look at things that are going on here. For today, we're going to be mostly concerned with the console, which is going to give me messages and errors and things like that I might be interested in. The network tab is important if you have something that's making other API calls. But for today, we'll focus on console. So this doesn't look that different. We just have a viz embedded in a page. We've done this several times so far. But along the bottom here, you can see I've got a series of buttons. And these buttons do different things, and they're all using the embedding API. So if I look at here, I can see, by the way, I did this viz, I included the filter so that we could fact check ourselves. Normally, if you were embedding and you were interacting with filters, you probably wouldn't show them. But just to kind of prove out here, so if I go back to VS Code and let's look at, this is kind of our standard way of starting up our viz. So I've got our Tableau viz component, our element, and then I've got our down here, our add event listener, where I'm adding an event on the first interactive. This code actually comes straight from the embedding playground that we've demoed before. But essentially what this is saying, this block here from 40 to 51, is basically for the viz, which I've said here, the viz is I'm querying an element called Tableau viz. And this await new promise, this is JavaScript's way of saying, I'm going to do something asynchronously. And when I'm done, I will do something else. So add an event listener. We covered that in the last topic, or excuse me, in the last series. And that basically just says JavaScript will do something when something happens. And I am subscribed here to a Tableau event type called first interactive. And essentially that's Tableau's embedding API's way of saying the viz is loaded and it's ready to go. So you can see there what I'm doing when that happens at right off the bat is console.log viz is interacted. That way I know it's ready to go. And this resolve closes out the promise, which is essentially, again, JavaScript's way of saying, I'm going to do something asynchronously. And then after I'm done, I'll move on. So if I look at what's going on here, if I refresh with the console open, you can see that once this, and this is resizing because I haven't given it a strict size, but once it's done and ready to go, there's my message, viz is interactive. So at this point, I can really start using the full embedding API because the web page is talking to my viz through the JavaScript files that we've imported here. So let's look at this first button. So this first button labeled get filters. Click on it. Let's see what happens. So I get some information here. The viz has the following filters applied, region and year. That checks out. The filter for region is currently set to Central, East, West, South. We know that. And for year, it's currently set to 21, all of the years, essentially. If we look at what code accomplished that, we jump down here into our second script section. We have, again, we have our query selector for a constant called viz. In JavaScript, a constant is something that once you, it's more of a, it's a one time you set it in your module and it, that value remains. So every time I refer to viz in functions inside of this script, I always mean this. It's kind of a shorthand, so I don't have to repeat it. You'll see in some of the other examples, there's some repetition to make things easier to read, but we'll go by one. There's another thing that we'll come back to here for an element called region select. But if we focus in here on the get filters, and I'll actually zoom in a little bit, hopefully make this a little easier for everybody to read. So on this get filters, so filters belong to a worksheet. And if you think about the way Tableau works, so I want to take the viz and I want to take the workbook that is embedded. And then I want to take the active sheet, which in this case, since I've embedded a sheet, is the sheet that we see. If you embed a dashboard, there are ways to get where the active sheet or get a sheet by its name on a dashboard. But to keep this simple, we'll stick with sheet for now. So then the next thing I'm going to do is sheet. I want to get the filters. I want to get information about the filters that belong to the sheet. And this get filter async, this is one of the functions that is inherited by this JavaScript file. This is one of the things that comes along with it. You'll notice here that I have the words async and await in front of these things. We touched on it last time as well, and I kind of talked about it a minute ago, but by its nature, JavaScript is asynchronous, meaning it will try to do things. If something's going to get finished sooner, it will finish before something that maybe started before that, unless you tell it, I need you to finish this before you move on. And in this case, since I want to print some of this information, if I didn't include this word await before this asynchronous function, JavaScript would just keep going before it actually had the information that this provided. And it would give me a whole bunch of blanks and nulls. And I might get some errors because the data is not ready yet. But this keyword here says, do this, don't move on until we're done here. So you can see there, I'm just console logging the sheet filters that we looked at. I'm getting some, just the names. So if I look here, this is a big thing within the JavaScript, or excuse me, the embedding API, is you get returned a lot of objects. So if I look at where I console log these sheet filters, the data that I got directly from the API, it's actually an array or a list of objects that have a few different values within them. So like here, there are two filters. One of them is, if I click on name here to review that, one of them is region, one of them is year order date. But there's also the things in here about applied value, the type, is it selected, is it an exclude filter, all good things that you wanna know. But in this case, I'm really only interested in the names of the filters. So that's where I can use an easy, very common JavaScript function here called map, which basically is, if you think about, if you're familiar with the concept of a for loop or a loop of really any kind, this is a way of saying, I want you to loop through every item in an array and create a new one based on some criteria here. So this line is basically saying, for everything in this list of objects with all of the data about the filters, all I want is each element's field name. Or the filter name I could get at some point. So then I'm saying the worksheet has the following filters, and that's where we got that print down here saying region year. So making sense so far, I think. The only other thing that this one is doing is this, there's a div up here holding this information that was hidden at the beginning. I'm just toggling it on the button click so that we can see it. So if I refresh again, we can see that it's gone. And when I reload it and do it again, I get that. So what about getting the data from the viz? That might be something useful that we want to interact with. So if I click on this get data button, let me clear out this console first, click on getting data, you'll see that there's a bit of a delay, but then I actually get some data about what's going on in the viz here. So you can see I've got rows from the underlying data, so the actual data set 10,000. And marks from the summary data, or the data that is actually used to render the viz that you see, there's 192. This would be the same number that if you're in Tableau Desktop, you see down in this corner right here. And I can see that that matches. I see Tableau Desktop tells me 192 marks. The embedding API gives me the same information via that. So one thing that I did want to call out is if I get this data and look at the filter options here. So I've got all four of the regions, but if I change some filters, or let's imagine that this viz was filtered when it was embedded, it had some default filters or user filters, whatever the case might be. And then I hit this get data again. Well, since this is based on the data that's rendered here, now I see that my filter options are only south and west. And if we think about that, if we're thinking about, well, one of the use cases about the embedding API is we might want to make a fully web experience that has our viz, but we want to make our own filters that are dropdowns or radio buttons, checkboxes, whatever you might want, that are actual web components. Now we have a problem because the data is telling us that we only have two options for this filter when we know that we actually have four. But just to look at what this filter, or excuse me, what this is actually doing, we jump back over here. Now we've got this function called get data. Pretty straightforward. Similarly, we want the active sheet, so we want the data from the sheet. And then this here, another asynchronous call coming directly from our API, which is get underlying data async. This is the one that I was saying gets all of the data. If you think about on Tableau server, if you're downloading full data, that's this data. And then what I'm doing here for that rows from underlying data is I'm just printing the length of that data that I get. The data is an array of objects for each mark or each row in the data. So that's where I get 10,000 rows. Same here on the next line, I'm doing a very similar call that functions almost identically, and I'm getting the summary data. So again, if you're thinking about downloading from Tableau server, the data that just represents what you see, not everything pre-aggregation or calculation, anything like that. And same thing, the length of that data, the length of the summary data is equal to the number of marks in the viz. So you can see that I'm just printing out once again, the length. Now, caveat, if you have some densification, if you have some other things going on, the number of marks may not be what you actually see, but this is a fairly simple visualization, so it aligns one-to-one. So then what I'm getting, I have another map function here to just go through and get the the second index one of the data, which is the second column in the data, and that is the region name. So I'm looping through all of the data in here and then creating what JavaScript calls a set. It's not quite the same as a Tableau set, but it is very similar to something if you're familiar with Python or other languages. Essentially, a set is an iterable or an array or a list of unique values. So I've taken every value, just its region name, and then reduced it to just the unique names. And that's where I get south and west. Now, again, I was saying we have a problem here, though, because if I say, for instance, wanted to populate a dropdown with all of my filter options, and I just load the viz and take this data as it is, I might not get all of the options that I want my user to select. So the next button that I want to highlight here is get all region values. So now that I have a couple of these regions filtered out, what if I want to get every possible value for region? That's what this button allows me to do here. So you're going to see some flashing here because I didn't cover it up or obfuscate anything on purpose, but let's see what happens when I click on this. So when I click on this, temporarily, you see the filters come back and then they go away again. And now I get printed out here all of my unique regions, and I can use that information to populate a dropdown. So now I can say, you know, okay, maybe I by default, I want to be filtered to just 2019 or just the West region, but I want my user through my own bespoke web UI to be able to select any relevant value for that dimension. So how do we do that? So if I switch back over into VS Code here, and I'm going to look at this function called get all unique filter values. Again, I want the active sheet here. The sheet filters similarly to above, to the first button. I'm going to await and get all that filter information, which again is an array of objects that has several things in it. And I'm going to do a different kind of loop on them here. So this is another way to declare a variable in JavaScript called var. It's all about scope. We don't really need to get into it. But essentially what I'm doing here is just saying that I want this variable to exist prior to looping through it so that I can add things to it, not worrying about whether my list is empty. If the list is empty and I try to refer to a variable that hasn't been declared yet, I may end up getting an error. This is just a way to prevent that. So you can see what I'm doing here. First, as I'm going through the filters as I got them from this async and creating essentially a list of the existing values. So south and west or south and central, whichever ones I had selected at the time I clicked on the button. So that's then I'm logging out what I had at first. So another feature that we have in the embedding API is to clear a filter. And all we do there is pass in the filter name. So if we look at the button further up here, I've got that. And on the click of the button, I'm calling get all unique filter names for the or filter values with the filter called region. So I go down here, I can clear out that filter. That's when we saw the check marks come back for a second. Now I can get my summary data. I can do the same thing I did above where I'm mapping to get all the region names. I create my set with all of the values. I'm printing those out. And then down here, the next thing I'm doing is inside of a dropdown box in HTML, which is called a select, each thing you see is called an option. So this is a way for me to create options inside of those selects. So I'm creating an option called all and appending it to that region select that I declared up here, which is just a select called region select. And then for each unique value that I got before, I'm creating another option. So that's how I get a filter or a dropdown here that looks like this. I have my all, and then I have one option for each filter value that I queried after clearing out any filters that were applied. And then at the very end, I'm just gonna reapply the filters that I already had so that the user doesn't really know that I did anything. You know, you could use the next example, I'll show some overlays and things that make this look a little more smooth. But again, if I were to just do this and show you the difference and click on get data again here, without doing any of the clearing the filter and reapplying it, we see again, the only option I would have to populate a dropdown with would be west. And that's not what I want, obviously. When I click on get all, I'm gonna refresh here so I don't double up. Once again, this will clear any filters that I have so that I can get every value and then reapply them. And we'll show that one more time here. So we've just got east, we've just got central and west. Click on all regions. Show up for a second, then they go back, and now I've got my full dropdown. So I'm going to skip the dropdown for a second and do these last three real quick, and then we'll go on to a more real world example here. So one interesting thing, let me just put these all back in here. One interesting thing that you might want in terms if you're building some sort of web dashboard or something where you want to call out outliers is something like max and min, things like that. So looking at the data here, what's the highest number in this viz right now? I can get that using this button. So the max value is from October. The region is central and it's 10,771. And same with the lowest value. The lowest value is from November. It's in the east region and it's negative 4,842. So how am I doing this? If we jump over back into our code here, I'm going to get down to, this is why there's one function here that's performing both of these tasks. And we can do that just by passing in an argument. This is a best practice whenever possible when you're coding. If you can make something reusable so that you have the least amount of repetition, that's always preferable. So this is kind of trying to show an example of that here. So just like anything else, just like all the other functions we've shown so far, I need the active sheet. And for this one, I'm going to use the summary data because I want to, you know, I'm only dealing with the marks I can see at this point. So I'm going to await that data. I'm printing it out so we can see that is printed out up here. It comes back as a data table with all 192 of my marks. That's because that's still open. There we go. If I look at what we've got going on next here, this is called a switch. This is essentially a case statement. If you're familiar with those in Tableau or other places, JavaScript, it's a switch, but then also uses the word case. But basically, this is a shorthand for an if, else if, else if, else if, until you find the match that you want. So I'm switching on the argument called value type, which I'm feeding in either min or max. So in the case of that value type being max, I'm using a reduce function here, which is another very popular, very highly used JavaScript function to interact with lists or arrays. And what this function does is basically filters based on certain criteria. There's also a JavaScript filter function. It works slightly differently. JavaScript has a max function and it's built in math, but it is very, very slow. And if you Google how to find the maximum value within an array of objects, almost everyone will point you towards this instead of max. All I'm saying here is for these P's and C's is this is the value that I'm comparing. Excuse me. This is the current values in the current maximum value, because I'm doing greater than here. And this is the comparison value. And basically, I'm just going through these and saying, if the value that I'm comparing is greater than the existing one, take it. Otherwise, take the existing one. Conversely, with min, I'm doing less than, but it's the same thing. This is a little bit muddy JavaScript, but this is a very standard way of just getting, if you have a list of objects, I want, based on one of those values in the object, which one is the max or which one is the min. So that's really all I'm doing here to get the min and max based on the value here, which 2 being the index, which is the third member of the data. So if I go through this data and show you what I mean by that, JavaScript, like many others, is a 0 index language, which means that if you have a list of items, you start at 0 and then 1 and then 2. So something that has the 2 was really the third. And if we look at here's one item. So the first thing in this object is the date, then the region, then the value. So I'm comparing the values in this case. All right. So we've seen now how to get max and min. Now let's start interacting with these filters that we have here. So let's say I want to go with Tableau's built-in filters for the most part, but I want to give my user the ability to clear them. I can do that with a clear region filter button. I click on this and I go back to all. We kind of did this already, if we really think about it. If I go up to clear region filter, it's that simple. I already did this. We already showed this in our get all region values. But essentially, just to recap, all this call comes with that JavaScript, the embedding API. We don't need to do anything special for this. And all we need to do is pass it a filter name. And so if we look at the button labeled clear region filter, on its click event, I call clear region filter and the name of the filter itself. And that's what gets me to be able to just go, okay, I just want to go back to all. I want to reset, essentially. But what about this dropdown that we were looking at before? Now we've got our region values in it. Wouldn't it be cool if we could use that to filter? Well, we can. So if I go through here and click on just one region, I can see it toggles to that region. I can do one at a time. With a select like this, you're getting one at a time. I can also do all and set it back to all. We could have used radio buttons or checkboxes, any form input that you're used to seeing, multi-select. If you wanted to do like a text field where you can control click and select multiple things, you could do that too. Select is just an easy example here, but let me switch over here and show what's going on back here. So if we go to a function here called apply filter from dropdown. So I have two arguments in this one, the filter name and then the event, which I will show you in just a second. But to show you what the JavaScript is actually doing here, I need the active sheet in order to interact with it. And then I'm again declaring a variable here because I need for the variable to exist no matter what. And then I will set its value later on. So I'm saying here, if the event value is all, then I'm just clearing the filter. If otherwise, then let's apply a filter and the filter name that I pass in here, and then the event value. Now you'll see that this is in a square brackets. So when you apply a filter through the embedding API, it always expects an array, even if you only have one value. So what I'm saying here is I'm giving it a list of values, but I'm only giving it one value because a dropdown can only have one value at a time. The last thing here, and this is in the documentation, the breakdown of this is in the documentation, which I'll link to and talk about in a second, is how do I want this filter to be applied? I can replace any existing filters. I can add to an existing filter. I can exclude. It depends on how you want your interactivity to work. In this case, I just want it to become the new filter. So I use the replace option. Looking up at the select itself, which is up here. And if you remember, we had another function that actually added in the different options here. So if I jump over to the inspector again, another nice thing that you can use any browser inspector for, is if I right click on something in the page and click on inspect, it will actually take me to the HTML for that element in the inspector here. So I can actually see here, okay, here's this select that I'm expecting. And if I expand it, there are all those options. That's what our function from before added in that's not in the base HTML. So to keep it dynamic. You know, you could, if you had a very simple viz that you don't anticipate changing that often, you could hard code these, but it's always best to keep things dynamic so that, you know, you have a release with a new column and everything's not broken, whichever. So, but essentially this select, you see that each option has a value. When I change the selection in this dropdown, it fires an event. And that event is basically the selection, what is currently selected. So when I'm saying here in my code that I want the event.value, that aligns to the value attribute of this option. So that's how I'm getting in the word all, or the word west or east or central, et cetera, et cetera. If I had, let's say radio buttons or checkbox, radio buttons would be similar, checkboxes where I could select multiple. I would send each one in. And in that case, I would probably want to do an add to a filter so that I could have many or few depending on how many I selected. So this has been an example of kind of how to abstract all of these things and do kind of one at a time. The next thing that I want to show is kind of a lot of it combined together and shown in a more sort of real world type example. And before I bring this up, I owe my standard disclaimer, I'm not a designer, so it's not perfect, but I think you'll get the point. So if I do the same thing here with index 2, I'm gonna open this with a live server. Now you'll see I got a little loader going on here. I've got some things happening. I got some viz coming in. Some stuff should start popping in here soon. And then once everything's done, my loader goes away, giving my user an indication that like, hey, everything's ready to go. You can do what you want from here. So looking at
these
two- I
don't know what you're talking about, Kyle. It's beautiful. Beautiful.
Oh, thanks, Zach. Thank you, Zach. I love Robert. I can see Robert on our team cringing at this alignment. It's great. But anyway, so you see here, this is now I've got something that's more like a portal or a selective viz, or, you know, I've got multiple vizs in the same place, which is totally possible. The embedding playground doesn't really cover how you would do this, but we'll jump in. But just to show you here, I've built what is essentially a dashboard. I mean, you could do a lot of this stuff with these sort of band-like cards in just a Tableau dashboard. But, you know, everyone knows there are limitations to the amount of formatting that you can do, you know, things like that. There, you can be limited. Sorry, I just noticed someone was waiting. You can be a little bit limited in what you can do. You can be limited in the fonts you can use. Can't really customize menus all that much. So you can really, this is really just meant to show that any data point, any interactivity that's in your workbook, you can make it whatever you want. So let's take a look at what we were doing, what we've done to kind of set this up. And again, if you were going to embed these in this fashion, you would probably hide the filters and the parameters on the embedded sheets themselves. It's more just to show the interactivity when we get there, but just kind of a best practice there. So if I jump over to index two, which is the other page that I'm looking at, one thing that I do that I also want to call out here is because JavaScript can get a little long. And, you know, in index one, I just included all of the code down at the bottom of the page, which is fine if you're not, you know, depending on the size of your project. But what I wanted to give a view into here was also using external JavaScript files. So in this case, I've got two files, one for my map viz and one for my line viz. And I've just got those. It kind of looks exactly the same. I'm just declaring functions, doing whatever I need them to do. But these just kind of sit in their own file out of the way. I don't have to worry about, okay, where is this in my HTML file? Just a separation makes it a little bit easier when you start writing more and more code. But all I need to do then in that case, so we're used to importing this. We've done this just about every time, importing our embedding API file from Tableau. And then under that, I'm just importing these two script files from my local machine as well. And as soon as I do that, I get access to all of the functions in both of these by name. Now, one thing to call out, it's important that you don't have name conflicts, or else you'll get whichever was imported last. So if I had a function with identical names in both of these, it would choose for me. So one thing to just call out there, be careful there. There are other ways to import. This is the simplest, but let's look at what happened here on page load. So if I refresh again, you can see that right when the page loads, a bunch of stuff is happening. I am loading in two separate vises. I'm loading in all of these different data points. I'm populating a couple dropdowns, and then my spinner's getting out of the way. So most of these functions are the same ones we just looked at, but let's look at how we string them together. I think that's probably the most important thing here. So first, let me turn on word wrap and then scroll down here. So don't be alarmed. I cheated and used a CSS framework called Bootstrap so that I could just shorthand a bunch of this and not have to make my own classes. So it's a little verbose, but the structure is basically just card, 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 viz. If I scroll down here to a script section at the bottom, so we've got this standard await promise, let me know when the chart is interactive. We saw this in the last one. I just am adding a event listener on first interactive to two separate vises here. Now, in the last example, we saw that it was, and if you get it from the API, the embedding playground, it's get query selector, which is just going to get the first element with the name you give it. In this case, I've actually given my vizs IDs, so that way I can keep them separate. So in this case, I've got mapviz is a div called mapviz, lineviz is lineviz. Reason why I do it this way is that way I have two independent vizs that I can interact with separately, and the Tableau API doesn't try to treat them as one thing. And then at the bottom, the most important thing that's happening here, these two up until this point is exactly the same. I have a function here called prep map viz and prep line viz. If I scroll down to the bottom, so I've got I've got my get filters, I've got get data, clear region, get all you need. These are the exact same functions that we had before, just extracted into a separate file for readability. And if I scroll down to the bottom here, I have a new function called prep line viz, where essentially I'm just calling all of these functions in order and then getting rid of my element called overlay, which is the spinner that we see that says, wait, something's happening. So because I put, again, because I put the word await in front of all of these, it will do them in order and then finally get rid of this overlay. Similar with map, I've got pretty much the same thing, prep map viz, and then I'm doing all of these things. Now, map viz is triggered first, so I don't hide the overlay when it's done, I hide the overlay when the second set is done. So that, to switch back over here, so now you can, again, you can see now that we have something that's starting to feel more like a web application instead of just embedded Tableau. And just the only difference on the side here, just to show you, so on this metric map, this additional viz, I'm using a parameter instead of a filter. You interact with these very similarly. So here in parameter controls, if I change this parameter called dot size to average discount, not only does it change my parameter, I actually think I had it defaulted. Let me change a different one. Not only does it change the parameter value within the viz, it also updates these. So now I have it set on average profit. If I change it, it'll go to average sales, and my top city and state, bottom city and state will update as well. So just to show you one last thing there with the updating of a parameter, and then we will open it up for some questions. So I've got this populate parameter select. So similar to before, we're going to wait for the get workbook params. And remember, parameters belong to the workbook. So in this case, I'm up a level from the worksheet. And then from that case, I want to filter out for a parameter, just the parameter name that I want, which in this case is dot size. I have an element in my document, another select called parameter select. And then kind of like I did before, I am looping through and creating options within that select. So the allowable parameter values that I get from here, I'm populating into my dropdown. And then the next complementary to that is I am updating. So same as before, we have a select that fires an event. I give it a parameter name. And when that changes, first, I want to show this overlay again. So flex means that it'll expand. So I want it to show and tell the user, hey, I'm doing something. And then the next thing that we do here is change parameter value async. It's a built-in function of the API. I give it the name and I give it the value that I want the parameter to have, and it changes it. Now, again, since this parameter changes some of our bands up at the top, I want to recalculate those. So these same that I called on load just get called again. And that's how I get some of these dynamic tiles up here that change with the metric or measure that my parameter is set on. So I know that was a lot, but I wanted to give a lot of really relevant real world examples. All of the code from this is available. We'll get the Bitbucket link here in just a second. So I'm going to stop sharing. Zach, do you want to share again? I don't have the presentation pulled up. I can make you a host.
Yeah, that's fine. I think you got to make me a host again.
Yep, I made you a host just now.
All right.
So while Zach's getting that pulled up, I don't think we... Okay. All right, go ahead, Zach. Sorry.
Cool. So like Kyle said, all of the stuff he went over and all the stuff that we've gone over in the past is available on his GitHub profile, as well as searching for either of us on the CodePen. So let's talk a little bit about what's next. So these take a lot out of Kyle and I. There's a lot of stuff that we've got to build for these. So just like the first time, we are going to take a break before the third session, or third series rather. We're not going to take a giant full year break like we did last time. Goal is we're going to come back in January, you know, give everybody the time to wrap up their years, have a good last couple of months, and then we'll come back in January all prepared, energized, and ready to go with the extensions API. In the interim, I would recommend that you follow both of us on Twitter. I'm not gonna say the other name. LinkedIn, Slack. There's always gonna be, I think, in between, more content that the two of us kind of promote, post, publish. Pal, I know, has some stuff on the way as well, which he's alluded to down here at the bottom. There may be some more content in between. So definitely, follow us. Take a look at us and keep an eye on us in Twitter, LinkedIn, Slack. and follow the hashtag DataDev for content related to the subject. With that, we're going to close it out, open it up for some questions and praise. So tell us how great we are.
I tried to grab the questions that were in the chat, but just to so everyone hears them if they didn't see. So Muhammad asks, is the preferred to keep the first interactive block within the HTML or move it to the JS file? It, like I answered you, either or, it kind of depends on your project. Just one thing, I didn't touch on it a lot. One thing that does change when you go to an external file is sometimes the scope of things changes when it comes to JavaScript, and also the order in which things happen. So if you're importing multiple things, the order in which they're imported can matter. So it's just important to understand that. I would look up, I would maybe Google JavaScript scope and order of imports, but either you can make either work. It's just easier for these examples to show it how we did. And Sean asked, can you use column names instead of column index values? Unfortunately, no. It's one of the things that I've complained about in the API before, is that when you get that response of data, you have column names as an array, and then you have data as an array of objects. So you'll have column names 0, 1, 2, 3. And then in a separate object called data, you'll have item 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, which is just the values. Now, the column names in the what's returned are in the same order as the data. So you could compare those two. And if you wanted to create like another object that has column name value, you could do that and get the index that way. So you don't have to, you know, I hard coded them for ease of readability, but you could definitely what's called zipping them, you know, combine two iterables based on a shared thing and get them that way dynamically.
Is it safe to assume that that order always stays the same?
It is. So like it is always the same. So I should say it this way. The order of the columns, I don't know if they will always be the same, you know, if you change things around, but order of the columns in the response will always be the same as the order of the data in the response. There are things that could make that order change, but they will always match when you make that call. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. I guess the worry would be if you added a new column to the data, that, you know, if it's returning it alphabetically, that because it's hard coded, now it's grabbing the incorrect column. So if you had you know, receipts instead of sales or something like that, and, you know, something came before it alphabetically.
Yeah. And to that point, if this were something I was going to use for work, I would never have hard coded them.
That's what I wanted to confirm.
But that's a good call.
There is a way to call it by name. So you're saying go through the zip function.
Yeah, unfortunately, the API won't accept it by name, but you can get the response and then basically create like a mapping object that's called index 0 is this name, this name, this name.
Yep. Okay, awesome. Thanks.
John coming in with the heavy generative AI coding tools to support their Tableau data dev. Zach and I have had, we've both played around with ChatGPT and API stuff, and it's scary. I'll say it scares me a little bit, only because you can pump something out that works, and that's what's you know, we've done it a few different ways, and for the most part, it's pretty accurate. The one thing that I think it's at the future for everybody when it comes to generative AI for coding stuff is, if it depends on what you want to do. If you need something for a quick demo or to help you understand how to get started a little bit better, great. That's where this stuff really excels. If you are trying to make something that's production ready or really get a deeper understanding of what's going on, it's probably not your best bet, because just like I've called this out in other sessions before, most of Tableau's documentation when it comes to this stuff is extremely verbose. It has a lot of stuff that you don't need. One thing that one time we did one of these, or maybe it was me, it pulled in some other Python library for the Tableau REST API, which it's perfectly fine. I've seen lots of Medium articles written with this API, but it's not Tableau's API. So it's like, if you really want to learn, you should probably stick with those tools. And if you're just saying, hey, ChatGPT, publish a Tableau workbook for me, you might not really get the level of knowledge that you think you are, but I'm an old fart. So that's the future and I know it. So
I'm going to take the other side of this. So so there's a couple things. So GPT-3 and 4, there is something, especially when you're working with code, to be said about the two and the differences between them. GPT-3 is usually okay. Like it'll give you code, but oftentimes if you try and actually throw it in to run it, it's just going to fail out on you because there's little issues. 4 though is usually pretty good when it comes to any code that it gives you. The thing that I would say about kind of learning is, yeah, if you don't really try and dig in and you just say, give me code to publish a workbook, like Kyle said, you're not going to learn anything. But you can, you know, use the commands that you send in the request to ask for more. So, you know, it's good to actually say, instead of give me a script to publish a workbook, give me a script to publish a workbook that is well commented and explain each part of the code and what it's doing. It's going to break it out and say, this is what's happening here. This is what's happening here. This is what's happening here. So you can use it, I think, to your advantage. The other thing that I would say is Tableau did announce at the conference earlier this year, Tableau GPT, not specifically integration in the API side, but there is stuff coming in calculation logic. For example, you can say, write a calculation that uses regex to pull out email addresses or something like that. So I do assume that there's going to be more integration across the product in the future, but they are, I think, heading in that direction at least.
Another hard question. Sorry.
Yeah, real quick. Let me just answer. So the follow-up on that, I don't know that there's a date for GPT. I think it's supposed to come out at least in beta towards the end of the year, and then I think the GA kind of thing will probably be first half of next year, but I'm not for sure on that one.
Yeah, at conference they were saying 2024.
Sean, what were you saying?
Yeah, so a lot of this right now relies on worksheets, things like that. Purely speculative, when this switches to kind of headless, you know, the headless BI, as it's called, I forget the exact name.
Yeah.
Do we think, you know, the function set right now is pretty, you know, light as far as what you're able to do through this API? Just purely speculative, what do y'all think? What have you heard as far as what that future looks like?
They showed I got really excited about a demo they showed at TC at the keynote, which was basically just being able to query data from a Tableau item, whether it's a workbook or a data source, just being able to say like, hey, I want data from this column with this filter, and that's all you get back. It's not, you got to instantiate it first. You don't even have to embed anything. I think that is very exciting. I think that opens up a lot of new ways to use data in Tableau. And you know, not necessarily have to bring along the viz. We'll make sure to include the link when we post the deck here. There's actually a lot more that this API can do, like mark selection changes and things like that. It was just too much to cover in one session, but you're right. I think once we get into the age of, okay, I have a viz, now I got to get the underlying data, but I got to remove some filters first or whichever. I think once we get to where it's like, I just want this data from something on Tableau server, that it kind of explodes where you can go with here and a lot more quickly.
And allows you to bring in D3 and other libraries that change.
There's some other JavaScript libraries that are good for lightweight visualization that feel like part of the page instead of something sitting on top of it. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Awesome. Thanks.
Cool. All right. I think we are past the time. So everybody, thanks for sticking around with us for a couple months and 5 sessions. Hopefully you guys learned something along the way. We'll talk to you again in the future.
Thanks, everybody. Have an excellent Friday and a great weekend.
Thanks, guys.